I am so excited for this conversation. I am sharing the stage right now with four people from whom I have been learning a lot over recent days, weeks, months, and years. And the topic for our conversation here, the kind of centering theme, is about power. You're more powerful than you think. And it's interesting. That is the title of my new book. But it's just by chance, you know. I don't know how that happened. But it's interesting because in my mind, from the time that I kind of conceived of this title, I placed the accent on powerful. You're more powerful than you think. And I began to hear from other people who were picking it up or seeing the title of our discussion here today, putting the accent on more. You're more powerful than you think. And one of the things that is kind of delightful to me about this whole day has been with language, with music, with symbols, with arguments, with ideas and American icons, people have been deciding to kind of put the accent in their own way on different things and to emphasize different dimensions of what you thought was the way to say something, right? Or you thought was the way to express or interpret something. And this idea that you're more powerful than you think is not just a woo-woo nice thing to say. This is at the very essence of the moment that we are in our country. And it's been the very essence of almost everything you've been getting a chance to hear and say throughout this day, both on stage, in our breakout sessions, at your tables, and what have you. And the one thing that I want to say to frame up this conversation is that we've been conscious today, certainly, about how we are in this cross-ideological, cross-partisan moment of bottom-up power. But we've been talking about that as if we assumed everybody knew in the first place what we mean by power. And so our point here, and the reason why we wanted to have the conference close with this discussion, is that we've situated ourselves in thinking about reckoning in the heart and repairing the way we use language and changing the ways that we conceptualize each other and the idea of the other. But now it's good, you know, as we prepare to go back out in the world, it's going to get back down to brass tacks. How do you get stuff done? How do you change things? And how do you teach each other to make change happen? So our panel here is about as good a collection of people to help share insights on that question as I can imagine. So I've been doing it all the same way. In fact, I meant to sit where Jose was sitting because I feel like I've been, let's switch. I feel like I've only been looking at you guys and have been neglecting this side here. To my right, Annie Leonard, Seattle's own Annie Leonard, now Executive Director of Greenpeace USA. You might have heard of them recently. They dropped a big banner on a crane that said resist near the White House. They, not too long ago, filled Elliott Bay with a flotilla of colorful kayaks and other watercraft to protest and ultimately block the proposed Arctic oil drilling rig. And we're going to hear about that and other work that Annie's doing. Next, my friend Berto Aguayo, who is a community organizer for the Resurrection Project in Chicago, and is a and comes to the work of really engaging with, meeting with, reactivating gang-involved youth from the perspective of someone who was himself once a gang-involved youth and has been able to rediscover other forms of power to create other forms of community and family. Next, my friend Brittany Packnett, who is activist, organizer, sort of like in superhero terms, by day is one identity, by night or other hours has another. One of her roles is as the National Vice President at Teach for America for National Alliances and Partnerships. I think I got that about 85% right, that title. But is work that quite now overlaps with her work over these last few years as one of the country's leading advocates broadly of what you might think of in the Black Lives Matter movement and specifically around police reform, doing that both as the co-founder of something called Campaign Zero, which we'll hear more about, and also as a participant in the Commission on 21st Century Policing that President Obama had created. And then last but not least, I'm so grateful for reasons that I'll explain in a moment for the presence of my friend Jose Antonio Vargas, who is the president and founder of, co-founder of Define American, is a Pulitzer Prize winning journalist, is probably, I mean, I've been saying this, I don't know if you say it this way, it comes differently coming out of your mouth, but is America's probably most well-known and famous undocumented person in ways that are, I'm sure, blessings and curses. And got that way, and let me put it this way, I don't mean to trivialize it, got that way because he decided to put himself out there as such and take the great risk of coming out as undocumented in a cover story in the New York Times Magazine several years ago, announcing to the world a secret that he had otherwise been keeping from the world. So I'm doubly grateful. Number one, Jose's been under the weather, and we're glad he's rallying right now. You look great, man. I can't, I'd like to look as good healthy as you do sick. But the second reason, of course, Jose and I have been texting, calling, emailing in the weeks since the executive order came down from this administration, and since it became clear that this administration was going to become more aggressive in deporting our undocumented neighbors, friends, coworkers, family members. And so, once again, Jose puts himself at risk just by going to the airport and just by showing up. And so thank you for being here. I actually want to start with that idea of showing up. I've talked in a lot of different settings about, actually goes back to a conference we had here, this is probably 2010 conference, when Bill Gates Sr. was speaking. Some of you may remember that. And Bill Gates Sr., the father of Microsoft Bill, wrote a memoir a few years back, and it's called simply Showing Up for Life, which, by my lights, is a pretty great definition of citizenship. I think one of the things that distinguishes all four of you is that you show up, right? You don't treat a problem as someone else's problem. And that's a disposition, that's an attitude. But once you show up, you also all know how to get it done, right? You know how to move people, you know how to move ideas, you know how to move money. And I would like to know, in the first place, I want to pose this common question to all four of you, and then we'll just kind of open it up a bit more freely. In the first place, how you go about teaching the elements of power to others, to people who may share a passion for your cause, really want police reform or to end police injustice or brutality, or really want to help the undocumented, but they just don't know where to begin or how to move the structure of power, right? So how do you go about in your work teaching the basic elements of power? And I don't mean necessarily political power. It may mean saying to, anyway, there are various forms of power. So let me just throw that out there and see. It doesn't have to be in any particular order. Who'd like to take that first? Don't be polite.
I'll go first. I'll dive in, being the only Seattle native, I think, up here. I'll tell you that Greenpeace's thinking and teaching about power is evolving. For the past number of decades, we're 45 years old, for the past decades, we really focused on sort of specific tactical applications of power and teaching people how to do those. So there's the power that comes from good information. We have all these scientists on staff, and we can tell you all about how many parts per million of carbon and what's happening in the Amazon forest ecosystem. So there's the using of information as power. There's the power of bearing witness. Greenpeace was founded on the Quaker principle of bearing witness. We will go bear witness to a wrongdoing and then come back and tell a powerful story. And that's another source of power. There's the power of moral conviction and actually putting our bodies on the line. We regularly engage in nonviolent direct action, putting our bodies on the line. And there's the power of sort of blaming or rewarding companies, like going after their brand to coerce them. And we've used those kinds of power for 45 years, and we've saved forests and banned chemicals and done lots of good things in the world. But we've recently been having a deeper sort of self-assessment about our power, and we realized that's not going to get us where we need to go. The kind of change that comes from those kinds of power aren't commensurate with the scale of the problem. And one reason is because using those kind of power, while it advances a campaign or a good thing in the world, it leaves intact the fundamental structures of power that exist. So we're still fighting the same power in the next campaign. So we started thinking about how to grow power. And one of the great things about power is you can grow it. And if you don't believe me, read Eric's book. You can totally grow power. It's infinitely expandable. And we realized we were leaving our biggest source of power on the table, which is our members. And so we are taking a very intentional shift towards greater people power. We like to say we're really good at getting people with power to make different decisions. Now we want to change who has the power, because that's how we open up the door for much bigger scale change.
That's wonderful. Who'd like to jump in next?
I guess we'll keep going with this. When I was thinking about this, when you sent us that question, in its most basic sense, I define power as self-determination, as the ability to boundlessly imagine your own future, your community's future, your people's future, and then actually go achieve it. And that sounds really basic, and yet that is power that so many of us have not yet grasped, right? Certainly not at the community level, often not at the individual level. But I do believe that the makings of that power reside in all of us. The question is whether or not we're gonna go seize it. And what that self-determination looks like in my day job with children is that we not only impart the academic skills that will allow young people access for whatever future endeavors they deem for themselves, but also that we approach our young people as full human beings with rich cultures and backgrounds that are to be affirmed and respected in the classroom, so that we are building up not just great learners, but also great leaders, right? Because if I give you the skills, if you don't have the confidence and the consciousness about the world to go and change it, then I've actually only done half my job, right? So that's what it looks like to build a self-determined, powerful child. When I think about issues of police violence, as co-founder of Campaign Zero, which is a 10-point policy platform to end police violence in America, imagining was the first piece of this puzzle. We had to set the number at zero, not at 10, not at 100, not at fewer, not at less people killed by the police, but zero. Because if we do not imagine and imagine big, then the vision that we will have set will limit us. Right? We will go as high as our expectations for ourselves. We will go as far as the future we have imagined for ourselves. And so we set that bar at zero, and then we wanted to give the people the power. We said the policy folks haven't necessarily been writing the things that have gotten us very far. In fact, it's helped get us where we are now. So instead, we're gonna take the researchers and the academics and the protesters and the activists and the regular everyday folks who live this every single day and their suggestions, coalesce it into a policy platform, and then actually help empower people to pass it. So we put out a report on use of force, identified 8 things that police departments can do to dramatically decrease police violence in their communities. And we worked with local organizers in Baton Rouge, and they are now the first region in the country that has this incredibly restrictive use of force policy, because they were able to pass it with somebody who had that vision and had that imagination. But if we hadn't set the bar high, if we hadn't imagined what was possible and then empowered the people to go after it, we wouldn't have gotten there. And the last thing I'll say is this. I've become really, really obsessed with the idea of love and power. And it's something that I just started thinking about. It kind of dropped into my spirit. And then I found a quote from Dr. King's speech to the SCL, his last speech to the SCLC. And he talks about the fact that philosophers in our tradition have gotten it wrong, that they often see love and power as two opposite things. But in fact, when we leverage power without love, that's exactly how we get to where we are now. That people exercise power in ways that are reckless, in ways that lack compassion, in ways that fail to see other people's humanity. And so he says, when you combine that love with power, it informs your actions differently. And so I've actually started to build a site called buildloveandpower.com, because every single day I get questions from people who are saying, how do I get started, right? And I said, what we actually need to build is a community and a space for people to think about these things, to explore, to reflect, and determine how they will do the work, how we will each do the work, and find that place where our passion, our talents, and our privilege intersect so that we can create social change. How it will affect what we wear, how will it affect how we work, how will it affect what we give, how will it affect how we empower other people.
Thank you, Brittany. Berto.
One of the ways in which I introduce the elements of power in my community is I think back to when I was younger, and I decided to join a gang at 13 years old. And I retrospectively look and try to analyze, why did I join a gang in the first place? Well, my mom was working from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. to try to provide a better future for me and my family. So I would go home, and there was really no one there. A gang provided me a sense of community that I didn't find at home. But also, gang members, you know, in the inner city, are the most visible presence of power in our communities, right? And when I started thinking about that, I thought, what if we were able to substitute what gangs do with the same tactics, but towards something positive, and towards peacemaking? So I'm a proud Back of the Yards native, and if that sounds familiar to a lot of you, it's because that's where Saul Alinsky and the birthplace of modern community organizing stems out of. And Saul Alinsky, in his book, Reveal for Radicals, he talks about an encounter with a young boy in the neighborhood in Back of the Yards. And they ask him, oh, what do you want to be when you grow up? And he says, I want to be like Big Butch, right? And I'm paraphrasing here for the sake of time. But he's asked, you don't want to be the president? You don't want to be the alderman? And the boy says, no, I want to be like Big Butch. Who was Big Butch? Big Butch was a local gang leader, right? And when I ask young people, and we do a training for young people on community organizing, I ask them to describe the most visible presence of power in the community, and they'll name the local gang, right? So that hasn't changed in the last 40, 50 years. So what we try to do is I try to translate the language of power to terms that they understand in the community and how it manifests itself every day. So what we do is we train young people in organizing, have them become literate in power, and have them believe and really take ownership of their own sense of power and their own sense of agency to then battle the street violence that they see every day in the neighborhood through camping out in the hottest blocks in the neighborhood or camping out in the hottest blocks in the city. But also, as we're fighting street violence and as young people are fighting the street violence that happens every day in our communities, also fighting the structural violence that created that street violence in the first place, which are not things that are mutually exclusive. Fighting street violence and fighting structural violence could be both done. And that's something that often is missed in arguments and in the media. When people are protesting police brutality, you often hear, why don't you guys protest the violence in your communities? Well, we do. It's just that doesn't get as much coverage. So that's how we try to instill the elements of power among young people in our community to be the agents of change for their own community.
Berto, I'll come back to you in a little bit. I want to dive deeper into the kind of process of transformation for you and what part that story of transformation for you plays in the way that you teach others. But Jose, for you, in all the work that you're doing, how do you try to convey these elements of power?
By the way, I'm really happy and glad to be here. I feel like Citizen University has been a part of my history in the past 6 years, so I'm happy to be here. I have to say, by the way, since we are talking about power, I was looking at my Facebook, where everything happens. And last night, a friend of mine just said on Facebook, I'm not going to quote her, I'm not going to name her. She says, hi, friends. This is a safety post to let you know I'll be boarding a flight from Seattle to San Jose at 7:15, leaving at 7:55 and arriving at 9:55. If I don't post a comment here before 10:30 p.m., something might have gone wrong at the airport. Please follow this post for further notice if you care about me. Thanks for reading. So this is an undocumented Korean woman who travels a lot between Seattle and San Jose, and this is what she posts whenever she gets on Facebook every 2 weeks when she has to travel here to Seattle, right? So to me, that's an interesting, that just tells you what's happening. I want to read a longer one just to kind of, for people to understand really what's happening, the sense of powerlessness and fear that has enveloped our communities. And I really want to give a shout out to Ruben Navarrete, the amazing journalist Ruben Navarrete, who with Maria Hinojosa has been pointing the fact that let's not forget that Barack Obama, President Obama, deported 3 million people, right? Many of them, by the way, not only Latinos, but Asian immigrants, black immigrants, white immigrants that we don't even talk about, right? But absolutely, the level of terror and fear has taken on a different atmosphere in this era. So this is a post written by a woman who's an undocumented medical student at a prestigious Ivy League school. I'm not going to name the school. She posted this last week. She goes, "Hey, I don't want to scare anybody, but this is the conversation that I'm having with my own parents. These are the things that we should really think about. Number one, know your rights." And of course, she links to ACLU and NIL, the National Immigration Law Center. Number two, memorize and or write down the phone numbers of lawyers and immigrant rights organizations. Number three, memorize or write down phone numbers of family wherever you come from. Number four, set aside money for an emergency fund. Number five, grant each other access to bank accounts to withdraw money and leave a personal check with a trusted individual to fill out in cash. Number six, leave spare key with trusted individual and arrange for personal belongings to be sold or transported to wherever you get deported. Number seven, continue to be entrepreneurial here or there. That was the last one. So that is the sense of powerlessness. So for me, when I think of power, and I think of what we do at DefineAmerican.com, which I know you will check out, I'm proud to say that Define American is the largest national organization led and founded by an undocumented immigrant. I employ 14 people, and we're growing, thankfully. Happy to employ people and provide them with health benefits that I can't even get myself because I'm here illegally. So what we do is give agency to people, right? I think it's so important at a time like this for people who are really feeling under attack. The reality of the deportation machine, the detention machine that all of you taxpayers are paying for, by the way, right? All of y'all, we all are paying for this. Giving people the sense of agency that they can define their own existence and find their own power. I'm reminded, one of my favorite authors, I'm going back to her right now, is Toni Morrison. I was rereading The Bluest Eye, which was the first book I read in eighth grade in a book club that I was in. And that was like 2 years after I arrived in this country. And I remember being very confused by this book because I'm like, why does this black girl want to have blue eyes? I was very, very confused by this book. And it wasn't years later that I understood one of the messages of the book is that what happens when you surrender to the narrative? What surrenders when we believe what society, what the government, and what people say we are, right? And then I went back, because of that, I went back to this lecture that Toni Morrison gave when she was receiving the Nobel Prize for Literature. And she said, "We die. That may be the measure of our lives, but we do language. That is the meaning of our lives." I think the language that must be created around migration, right? Anybody here who's an immigrant, we are one of 244 million people in this world who are migrants. We are moving because of political reasons, economic reasons, environmental reasons, and the United Nations doesn't even have a language for what those rights are. Us having the power of creating what that is, to me, is incumbent on people's narratives and how we shape what people and what governments think of us.
You know, one of the things that connects everything that you all four have said, and thank you for your just very moving and powerful reflections on this question, is in the first place, this overlap of concepts, power, agency, voice, right, and different definitions that people have. And, you know, I think one of the things that's, I define power as a capacity to ensure that others do as you would have them do. Okay, and that's a little bit more like menacing sounding than self-determination, right? But if you kind of sit with that for a moment and you think about it, and you think about, like, again, forget about politics, like, my friend, my relationship with my friend, or my relationship with my wife, or my relationship with my daughter, right? All of our relationships, public and private, involve outcomes that we would prefer, right? How do we move things toward those outcomes, right? Civic power is simply that capacity applied in public life, right? And there's nothing inherently dirty or evil about this thing, this capacity. Right? It is like fire, just a question of what uses we put it to, right? And so one of the things that strikes me here is that as we get more precise about what we mean by power, it starts to burn away notions. Well, let me put it this way. it begins to reveal the way that, Jose, when you're talking about the power to reclaim a narrative or to remake a narrative or to bust apart a narrative, right? That is one of the most foundational imperatives of power in civic life, right? Because it recognizes that one of the most basic laws of civic life is that power justifies itself, right? The wealthy justify their wealth. White supremacy justifies itself, right? Male supremacy justifies itself in 100 different narratives and 100 different forms of propaganda and forms of just kind of habit, right? Little rhetorical things that we don't even perceive, right? And so one of the most basic forms of power is busting through that cycle of self-justification. And I'm wondering for all of you, I mean, you've described here how you out in the world do this work, and I loved, Annie, how organizationally you've begun to make this pivot from focusing only on people who have visible kind of forms of peak power more and now more to the kind of untapped pool of people power. But I'm actually, I'm curious now hearing all four of you, for you personally, what was that pivot? When did you begin to find in your own sense that, wow, I actually, my own capacity for power is infinite. My own capacity, as Brittany was saying, to determine my future is in fact in my hands here. When did that begin to click and form for you in your lives? Who would like to, Berto? Yep.
Well, I had that moment my junior year going into my senior year of high school. I was serving an in-school suspension for a gang fight, and because I was so often in the office, I had really built a close relationship with my principal. So she comes in, she throws me a job application for the summer, and she says, it's a job, apply. If you need a recommendation letter, I'll write one for you. The job was for Mikvah Challenge. If you guys don't know, Mikvah Challenge, there you go, heard some claps. So Mikvah Challenge is an organization that engages young people in the civic process. And I applied to this job. When I go downtown, it was like my first time going downtown to the downtown Chicago. And I have an interview, and as soon as I go in, I'm like, I know I'm not going to get this. I didn't even dress up the way I'm supposed to. I was still dressed like a gang member. You'd find me on the south side, and I was going downtown for an interview. So I go in, and I get out, and I say, I'm not going to get this. And I get a call. I got the job. So this summer of my junior year going into my senior year of high school, interning at an alderman's office on the north side of the city of Chicago, and when I was there answering calls for constituents, helping them get their trees removed, helping them, you know, do community cleanups, doing health fairs, I really saw the alternative to what I was doing on the street. Because I feel like young people across the country really go sometimes into gangs because they have this love for their community, right? And the only platform that invites them to express that love for their community, unfortunately, is a gang. Right? And to me, I saw in the alderman's office and in the civic arena a different way that I could be expressing that love for my community. And I remember after I came back from that internship, and there was a lot of other forging moments that led to my transformation, including some of my best friends getting killed in the streets and my mom's refusal to lose me to the streets. But I decided that I was going to get out of the gang, get a beating, and I was gonna try to do the most that I could to make my community better once I had that realization. And that was my moment for me.
Brittany, I don't know whether for you in answering this question, you are rewinding back to a point earlier in your life or maybe even sitting with what you alluded to just a moment ago, this kind of epiphany you've been having about love and power. Where does your heart and head go when I asked that question?
My head went to a million places, right? My head certainly went back to when I was running Teach for America in St. Louis, trying to raise a 27-year-old black girl trying to raise a $4 million budget, and had a college dean say to me after I had taken my hair out of braids and was wearing it straight, never to put my braids back in. And then I went and got the longest braids I could get. Like, they were, like, down to my knee, right? And it was this moment of like, you don't have control over my hair. You don't get to touch it, and you don't get to tell me what to do with it. So my brain went there. But if I really think back, I think back to attending a predominantly white private high school in St. Louis County, where I grew up, 45 minutes from where I grew up, on the white side of town, and being spit at by a white man who was a year older than me, who was fed up with the diversity and equity work that I was doing in our school, right? I was stirring up a problem where there wasn't one, right? Because as long as we're silent about racism, it doesn't exist, right? So I remember being spit at by this guy who was the son of a trustee and very well-to-do, certainly had much more wealth than was in my family, and receiving only a terse, forced apology from him in the head of school's office, and nothing ever happening, and me burying that story for years. That happened in 2000. In 2014, that same high school, my alma mater, asked me to come back to talk about what was happening in Ferguson, because I had been on the ground protesting for 2 or 3 weeks, and I decided to come back, and I had no idea what I was going to say. And my track coach from high school said, "You'll know what to say when you get up there." And for the first time in 14 years, I told that story. And that was a moment where I had to reclaim my own power, because what I was facing every single day was tear gas and pepper spray and MRAPs and emails floating back and forth of white donors who disapproved of my activities and who decided to pull their checks from what we were doing to the tune of almost $500,000 that year. And so the risk that we take on when we show up and when we stand up and when we are vocal is not something that I hadn't known before. But having that moment of reclaiming my power allowed me to practice the kind of courage that I would need over and over and over again. It's the same kind of courage I needed to go and raise, not only to make up that $500,000, but to actually raise so much money that we had never seen that kind of money before, right? It gave me the courage to go get the long braids. It gave me the courage to run down to Baton Rouge when Alton Sterling was killed. And so these moments when we seize our own power, but when we practice it, I think are what ready us for the tough moments.
Thank you, Brittany. And here, Jose, how would you like to?
So after the election, I have a lot of lawyers. The lawyers were like, "Move out of your apartment in LA because our address is public and we don't want an address so they can pick you up. Do not fly anymore. Do not fly anymore." And at Define American, we've done more than 800 events in 48 states. Flying around is like my job, you know, going to Tea Party meetings, talking to Republicans. That's a big part of my job. And then one of my lawyers, the most radical one, Mexican-American woman in Chicago, said to me, "Jose, I think you should go to Canada. I think we should contact the Canadian Prime Minister to create a special visa for the people who are unwelcome here to go there, and you can help get this happen." The moment she said that, it scared me, because she's the most radical one, and she's the one telling me to go leave. And then after that happened, Nancy Pelosi invited me to be one of her guests for the State of the Union, for the joint address. All of this was happening in a matter of like 5 weeks, right? So I had to get really centered around myself. Like, you know, there's the public, whatever, this has become the most famous, whatever that means. And then there's me, the person, and like, where does my power lie in a moment like this, right? Because I'm in a position of visibility in which whatever I do, if I get arrested, it's breaking news on CNN, right? So I had to really sit with that and made a decision, as Eric knows, because I was texting him with this, that, you know what, I'm going to show up. I'm going to accept Nancy Pelosi's invitation. I'm going to be a guest. I'm going to sit in that chamber as President Trump addresses the joint session of Congress. I am going to look them in the eye, and I'm going to say, if you want to arrest me, I'm right here on F-32 in the House chamber. My power as not even as an American, as Filipino, whatever, but as a human being, to say that I am not what you think I am and this is not what you think it is, was catalyzed at that moment. And it's not about the detention and deportation. Like, I've done the detention part. The deportation part, you know, I'm not that scared of anymore. What I am scared of is allowing a presidency to scare me from myself. Like, I will not do that. I will not do that.
Annie, one of the things that is so moving about some of the direct action that Greenpeace has been involved in recently has been, I sat in on some of your breakout session earlier today, And just when I came in, you were talking about what's the social science concept? Social proof. The idea of social proof, that one of the greatest determinants of what people will do is what other people are doing, right? And so if you see just one other person doing a thing that seems risky, that just increases dramatically the likelihood that you'll take that risk, right? Which goes to the heart of the kind of people power you're trying to activate, getting people to show up together in something like the Chi-Activist flotilla, so that it's not just a single superhero person taking on the system, but there is that power in the company of others, right? For you, this kind of awakening into your own power in civic life, did that come in a similarly collective environment, or was it more of a different kind of awakening?
It did come in a collective environment. Almost every good thing comes from a collective environment, right? I am an environmentalist, and I was educated in science, and I was trapped in this myth that a lot of environmentalists are, that the truth will set us free. And the reason I say it's a myth is because we got so dang much truth that we would be free if it actually worked. I mean, think about the reams and reams and reams of truth we got about climate change, and the president still says it's a hoax. So when I went to college and I studied environmental science, I was naive enough to think that really mastering the science and explaining that to decision makers would lead them to make appropriate decisions. And I was going to college in New York City. My passion is really around pollution, and I know a lot about the science of pollution. And the city government proposed building 7 garbage incinerators in low-income communities of color, incredibly polluting facilities. So I had my thesis about why we should not burn our garbage, and I marched down to City Hall with all of my scientific information, and I really thought that it would matter. And it didn't matter. And so I started getting involved in the protests to fight these things, and I realized they're not planning these garbage incinerators in these low-income communities of color because they don't understand the health impacts of dioxin. They're doing it because they don't care about these people. And there's environmental racism at play. And they have prioritized profits over public health. And I realized this really has nothing to do with the science. We still need the expertise. But I would say the expertise should be on tap, not on top. It is not the scientific expertise that's going to win this. It is building power from the bottom up. You've got to get your facts right, but don't count on those facts, because it's about power.
You know, thank you, Annie. I think it was Jose who mentioned earlier, you know, the ACLU, and it's fascinating. I mean, that organization, of course, has, like so many, has seen donations surge in recent weeks. But they've also done a pivot similar to what Annie's describing with Greenpeace, where they've come to realize that, we can't just do our bread and butter work of fighting in the courts and filing lawsuits and motions to stay. We've actually got to activate people on the ground, whether already in their chapters or potentially in their chapters. And they, too, have launched a movement that they, too, are calling, hashtag people power, right? And what's striking to me here in all of these is the awakenings that you've described here personally have a lot to do with choices that you make knowing that there's going to be a cost, okay? And sometimes that choice and that cost is personal. Right? Or even personal, professional, the way Brittany, you described the choices you made meant that some of the donors in your day job just didn't want to be associated with you anymore, right? And Jose, for obvious reasons, the choices you make in private life are wholly public and consequential. For us in the room here, in thinking about the choice making that we make every day, what's some guidance you can give us about, how we can make choices strategically, right? And how we can make choices knowing that, yeah, we might lose something here. How can we find the courage to put something at risk, to engage on an issue that, to go and protest somewhere in a place where protest increasingly might be criminalized is to put yourself at risk, right? If you work in the government and you want to make fact and truth known when those in government don't really want to, you put yourself at risk for getting fired, right? What are the risks that we should be thinking about here, being willing and able to take? The people in this room don't necessarily run organizations in the same way that you do, and yet every one of us, it doesn't matter what position you stand in, you face a choice and you have to weigh this kind of cost and benefit and the risk and the consequence. How do you counsel us to make those choices and navigate those risks?
I just have to say, like, even in just listening in the panels here today, just taking the risk of being wrong. meaning, I'm maybe it's the journalist in me. Like, I am fascinated by certainty, because I as a journalist, as a writer, like, you know, we live in the gray area of trying to make sense of how people get to black and white, right? So I think when people always tell me that they have an idea as to why what happened, I'm like, you do? Well, not everybody does. So, like, how did you get there? So to me, the taking that risk of being wrong and saying that you're wrong about something, the risk of being uncomfortable about something. Like, you know, I was just on this thing last week and the guy said, you know, you make me very uncomfortable. And I said, well, good. you know, I've been uncomfortable since I found out that I was your illegal faggot. So I'm just sharing the uncomfortability, right? If you're uncomfortable, that's on you, yo. So, like, you figure that out, right? Like, I can't, and, you know, to all the, you know, but, and the message here, you know, it's really tough because me personally, with what we're dealing with, it's so hard to empower a community of undocumented people who are living in this new terror that was, you know, enabled by the Obama administration, the Bush administration, and all that, by politics, right? It's hard to do that while at the same time trying to inform people who know nothing about it, right? Like, I am now questioning I was wrong in making the assumption that we know what the choir is. You know when we say preach beyond the choir? I don't know who the choir is anymore. I was in a room full of 80 documentary filmmakers in a townhouse in Brooklyn, people who watch Democracy Now! And MSNBC. I get in front of them and I'm like, there's this thing called DACA. Four people out of 65 people knew what I was talking about. Michael Moore goes, what is that? If Michael Moore doesn't know what DACA is, we're in real trouble. So I think questioning even that, I think that in itself is a risk worth taking. Like, I think, get yourself uncomfortable with, like, who do you think your allies are and why are they your allies?
And by the way, for those who might be uncomfortable not knowing what DACA is.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. The whole room. DACA is a program that President Obama, is an executive order that has given permanent status to 800,000 young people in this country who have to pay, But just so you know, they have to pay $495 to the government so that the government doesn't deport them. And they gave their name, their addresses, their biometrics to the government that now President Trump is in charge of.
And so now when it's time to renew your DACA status,
2 years,
right, people are scared to go and give that identifying information to this administration.
Yep, exactly.
And this program, which was at the time Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals, seen as a win, right, is, half measures are half measures. And depending on what direction you're looking at them from, they're either good or bad. Other responses, yeah. So
I want to take this question of choice a little differently. I made the decision about a year and a half, 2 years ago, to love myself. And to love myself so radically that I am worth more whatever I lose, right? I am worth more than whatever I could lose. And that in and of itself is a radical proposition, because, like, black women were your mules, your whores, or your hidden figures, but we were never supposed to be self-determined, proud, like, authentic people, right? We were never supposed to be fully human. We were never supposed to write the album Solange wrote. We were never supposed to win the Oscars that folks, like, that Ava DuVernay was nominated for, right? Like, that was never supposed to be us. And so when I decided to confer my dignity upon myself, irrespective of whether or not you saw it, I started winning, right? Because the whole proposition of the win was different. The win was different, right? The win is, do I still have my integrity? The win is the choice that I made to love myself today something that made you uncomfortable, right? Because actually that is totally a win. And so the choice that I really want people to make is to love themselves radically, because it forces people to operate in your space differently. And imagine if all of the folks in this room not only love ourselves radically, but recognize the love that other people have for themselves and start loving them too, then we're on a different playing field.
You know, and on that note, on being radical, one of the suggestions that, you know, that I always take and that I always try to pursue is to practice radical diplomacy. And what I mean by that is, you know, pursuing radical ideas, and but also being conscious of the fact that, you know, you got to build relationships in order to get those ideas to the forefront. And I think sometimes when people say radical, there's this, like, you know, taboo of what a radical is, but look at who's in the White House, right? This is a time to be radical, right? This is a time when we have to pursue radical ideas, because obviously the system is not working, right? So practicing that radical diplomacy. The second one is making sure that we're not fooled by our own righteousness, right? Sometimes we think that we're right and that our own experience is the valid one, but being able to hear the other side to make way, you know, for common ground to be visible. But then also knowing your non-negotiables. That's my third one. Knowing the non-negotiables. What are the non-negotiables in my experience and in the work that I do? Because at a time like this, when so many people voted for an individual, right, whose agenda's success depends on the demise of my people or of people like me, then I'm not going to negotiate that. But there's other things that through radical diplomacy that I'm willing to negotiate with other individuals who don't see my demise as a success of their own agenda.
I want to interject one thought, though, because the phrasing you just used is super interesting to me. And, you know, a radical notion of empathy would take us to, you know, in a couple weeks I'll be at this event with a guy named J.D. Vance, who's the author of this book that's been a number one bestseller for a while now, Hillbilly Elegy. Right, J.D. comes from Appalachia, from, I think, Ohio, industrial Ohio, and made choices where he didn't go on the path that he was set to go on and ended up on a path that led him to Yale Law, Marine Corps, Yale Law School, corporate law, et cetera. Right? And he's looking back now on the place where he grew up, right, and the distance that he's traveled, both geographically and identity-wise. Right? And he's trying to, the reason why this book is the number one bestseller is not just after the election, people wanted to understand Trump country, and here's a person who comes from Trump country, but, you know, has a Yale law degree, so he must be a valid translator, right? It's not just that, but if you practice radical empathy, the phrasing you just used was, this guy's agenda means the demise of me and my community, is literally the language that you hear coming from Appalachia right now. Right? It is literally the language that you find marbled throughout another book, Strangers in Their Own Land, by Arlie Hochschild, about Tea Partiers and other kind of completely radical, disaffected folks in South Louisiana. And it wasn't about Obama, per se. It was about something that people have been saying throughout, that Ruben was saying earlier today, that elites are working toward the demise of me and the people I know and love. Right? And so I think I want to flip this. I mean, it takes a moment of radical empathy to kind of realize, wow, you all were saying the same thing here, right? Different presidents, different situations, but same thing. And Annie, I want to just kind of close this with you, because one of the things that when you get into that moment of realization, right, that there is this sense that's not just about political divides, racial divides, or these other visible divides, but about these structural divides of the powerful, the people with power, and the people, right? The elites and everybody else, right? And, you know, let's not kid ourselves. If you're in this room, one way to slice that thing is to say that you're the elite, right? You're educated enough to be listening to references to Toni Morrison and getting references to whatever it is, and following the news and knowing what happened with ACHA yesterday and so forth, right? This is already a room of people who are highly literate. But the question I have for you here is, in the environmental movement now, as you're trying to build people power, how do you bust through this notion that some people have that, well, how do you deal with this elite versus populist divide here? And how do you activate that in a way that can be beneficial?
Well, a couple of things. One is, even elite people have to breathe the air. So we actually, you know, much to their dismay, I'm sure, but there actually are some commonalities that we're all breathing the same air and drinking the same water. And so a lot of the environmental benefits that we are calling for, like a transition to a clean energy economy, benefit us all. And it turns out, actually, that if you screen for commonalities, there are a lot of commonalities. It turns out that most people do want their babies born without 165 industrial chemicals already in their blood. And most people do want the Earth's climate to stay in that range in which human life can continue. Like, we do actually have a base foundation here. The catch is that power concedes nothing without a demand. And good economic arguments don't work, scientific data doesn't work, common sense doesn't work. The thing that we need to bring to the table is power. And when I look at the environmental movement, we have created every single thing we need for a sustainable and just society. We have those model policies. We have incredible innovative technologies. We have economic case studies. We have every single thing we need, except we haven't leveraged our power to make it so. And so that's where we have to be focusing, is on building the power.
Well, I just want to conclude this conversation, and I say just this conversation because this will continue in many ways around this room and beyond. Just stitching together a few things that the four of you have said. There's actually kind of a nice space between two mathematical notations. One is zero, and one is infinity. So what Brittany and her colleagues at Campaign Zero had to do when you all decided that Campaign Zero wouldn't be called Campaign Fewer or Campaign One or Campaign a little bit less than last year, right? wasn't just a marketing or a language thing, it was a strategic choice of imagination. You imagined zero. That's crazy, right? To imagine zero, and you now force everyone else to imagine zero, and working backwards from that imagined zero, kind of map out and plot out a path, right? And indeed, you all have put forward a policy path to zero, right? But I just want to name that fact, that the imagination, the act of imagination of calling something Campaign Zero in its audacity is beautiful and kind of the essence of this kind of reframing of a narrative of what's possible in politics. This other mathematical concept, infinity, goes back to something that Annie was referring to, this idea that, you know, we live in an age where people are scared because people think that the world is zero sum, right? And they think that if some people are getting ahead, then I'm falling behind. They think, if you're white and you think that, you know, our culture and our boardrooms and our politics are now filled with non-white people, either in power or demanding power, that must be to my detriment if I'm not a person of color, right? As China rises, people in the United States think that must be to the detriment of the United States, right? We have this zero-sum scarcity mentality. And one of the most basic elements of exercising civic power is to bust people out of zero-sum thinking and to remind people that power is, in fact, infinite. And again, as I was saying this morning, I don't mean this in a touchy-feely woo-woo way. I mean that unlike like energy in a system of physics, in which there is a finite amount of energy, and the laws of conservation of matter and energy tell you that if someone gets more, someone else has to be getting less, when it comes to power, it is infinite. You getting more power by learning how to organize people, you getting more power by learning how to find your voice, you getting more power by following Brittany's example, learning to love yourself that radically, didn't make me any weaker. Didn't make me any less capable, right? You being able to give a speech in public and rally people around something didn't make me suddenly silent, mute, or tongue-tied, right? All you have done by doing that is add to the net amount of power in the system, right? And one of the most important ways for us to create power out of thin air is simply to organize. Right? Organizing is magic. It is the magic dust of civic life.
Woo! That was creepy.
So magic that you turned out the lights.
That was beautiful. And what I want to say here, I don't know if that was our magic going or if that was our team telling it's time to move on to the ice cream. But in either case, I want to wrap with this simple thought, that as we depart today, some of you came in groups from colleges and universities all around the country, from organizations like the Family Independence Initiative. Yeah. From all different backgrounds and sectors. So some of you came as groups, and you will leave as groups. And you will think, I met a former friend and colleague, from the Seattle Public Library who told me, I didn't even know this, that a whole group of librarians had had a pre-conference meeting coming to the conference, and now we're gonna have it. This is great. But others of you came seemingly alone. Others of you came thinking you were seeking something, and you came here in search of that, and you maybe didn't know other people, right? In either case, our job now is to connect these dots and to organize ourselves and each other, right? To build on this foundation of radical, honest self-love, radical diplomacy, radical empathy, the willingness to kind of take inventory of your power and then be able to make informed judgments and calculations of the risks you will take with the capital that you have, right? Willingness, as Annie described, to actually analyze the ways in which maybe the ways you've been doing stuff aren't working for you, even though they're working 80% of the time. You're getting 80% of something that's not good, right? All of that self-analysis now can be done in selves action, in the collective, in selves help. And this moment right now for selves help is one of the most beautiful things about our time and why I keep coming back. I know Jim Wallace during our earlier conversation said he distinguishes between optimism and hope, right? I'm both optimistic and hopeful. That's how I square that circle, right? I am optimistic because I feel the energy here. I feel the energy with my friends all across the political spectrum who are claiming their voice and their place right now. And I'm hopeful because people are doing this not blindly, but they are reckoning with just how much pain there still is, how much fear there still is, how much risk there still is in being human in America right now. And so we beg of you, as you leave today, to organize. You don't have to be a professional community organizer. It just means meet someone for coffee next week. It means continuing this conversation at the dinner table. It means getting a circle of study or a circle of activism together, right? Organize. When we organize, we will remind ourselves just how infinite power is. And we will, as Frederick Douglass said, not only remember that power concedes nothing without a demand, but that when we actually make ourselves the power, we are the demand. We are the demand. And the system is no longer a thing that is outside us and frustrating us, but the system is something that we then gain responsibility for and ownership of. So please join me in thanking our remarkable closing panelists here, Jose Antonio Vargas, Brittany Packnett, Berto Aguayo, and Annie Leonard. Thank you so much.